Anyway, we must move on because I've got with me a man who the last time I saw him while in America, he was wearing his uniform, and a very smart one it was, because he was a very, very senior police officer there. And I have to say, he was absolutely fantastic to us when we went out to do our live broadcast. And I'll never forget the fact that he allowed us access to the site of the Twin Towers, and in fact to a very, very special part where families would have left and their memorials and all of that. We were very, very fortunate, and it was very generous of him to do that at the time. Anyway, he's with us here today without his uniform, but still talking about the role. He's Paul McCormack, and it's great to see you, Paul.
Great to see you again today, Shaun. How are you?
I'm good. And of course, you rose to a very, very high position in the New York Police. You didn't make it in the Gardaí, or even to the Gardaí, because you were too small. And yet here you were in New York, top man, more or less. Tell us more.
Yeah, well, when I was, I did my leaving in 86. It's the Norwood Vocational School. And that was the Charlie Haughey tighten your belt strap days, you know. And there was really, the economy was back then like it is right now for the young ones coming out of school. And there was nothing for us. It was either go on the dole or emigrate. And I had the good fortune of being born in America, so I had my American passport. And at the time, the big three was teaching, banks, and the guards. And I was an inch too short. They had the height requirement back then for the guard. It's been gone since then. So, but I've grown that inch since then, by the way. But I was 17 at the time. But I was very fortunate to have my American citizenship. Emigrated after my two older brothers, Pete and Seamus. Seamus joined the Navy. My brother Pete, he went to America 6 months before me. And I did construction for a while. And there was an Irish detective over in New York that gave me the application for the NYPD, which I filled out. And thank God I got in the police department in 1990. And in the NYPD, for the first three promotions to sergeant, lieutenant, and captain, there's you take tests, civil service tests, and I happened to hit the tests all at the right time. They come up very seldom, but I hit them right in the right time, and I became, I was a captain with 9 years on the job. I was the youngest captain in the history of the NYPD, and then I became the youngest precinct commander in 2001 when I became the commander of Fort Apache, the 4-1 precinct, all stuff that I'm very proud of. Mm-hmm.
Now, you were there, I know, for the terrible incident that happened, 9/11, they call it. You were in New York, but you weren't at the Twin Towers, but you started to hear the commotion, didn't you, really?
You know, I was actually, I teach the police to be sergeants, lieutenants, and lieutenants to be captains. I still run a school in New York, and I was on my way to Fordham University and on the morning of to teach a class of police officers that were looking to be sergeants, and I was listening to the radio on the way into that class, and that's when I first got the word that the plane had hit the building. And at the time, we didn't, you know, it wasn't a big story at the time. But then when there was reporters that were, you know, came on the air that were saying, listen, this is more than just a small plane hitting. This is like a large passenger plane. And there was debris falling. And then my phone started going off. And I started getting, as a precinct commander, we started getting reports coming in over our phones. And, you know, we knew it was starting to ramp up. But at the you know, until the second plane hit, we didn't realize that it was terror. But once the second plane hit, it was all hell broke loose, Shaun, and it was chaos.
Well, it was like Armageddon watching it. I mean, what was going through your mind whenever the calls started to come in big style?
Well, there's, you know, as a police officer, you have to go with your protocol in the police department and realize that the community is relying on you right now. This is like, you know, we knew it was terror when the second plane hit, but we never expected the buildings to come down. That was something we never even thought was going to happen. And it was mobilized time, because then the reports came in about the Pentagon, and there was another plane up, and word was coming in that the White House, there was a lot of misinformation going around at the time, that the White House had been hit, and all kinds of other stuff. And we were worried about securing, as precinct commanders, we were responsible for certain geographic areas. And we were concerned about securing our areas and speaking to our supervisors and our upper executives in our job. We had to focus on our areas.
But it's very strange. It surely must be as a top cop. Whenever you are trained for the worst scenario, you're trained for the worst scenario. Yeah. And this is something that they haven't actually thought about. And you're hearing maybe the White House is going to be attacked, maybe the president's under threat now. Are you at any stage thinking here, we're going to wake up to a very different America here?
No doubt about it. I remember, like, as you know, I'm doing an exhibition, and part of the exhibition is we have the audio from the day, the police chatter from the day the police calls, and there are numerous police officers, you know, while this was happening, were saying, get a hold of the military, get the military up, get the Air Force up. And that was something that had come, like, that's something we couldn't handle. Like, we can't handle aircraft hitting buildings. That's completely beyond the realm of our scope of our, you know, we would never even think of something like that happening. And we didn't. Nobody thought that type of an attack could happen on American soil. And we were, as I said, we needed help from the military. And there's all kinds of protocols that have gone into place right now since America's changed, New York has changed.
Did you think, oh God, we're going to, lawlessness, I mean, what was, because a whole film would probably go through, I know it was for me, because I was sitting out there actually, or standing out there, I'd just come back from lunch, the TV was on here, and I looked in and everyone was standing, and I thought, what's going on, and I don't know, there was something, it was captivating initially, and then you realise something is happening in the world that made you feel uneasy as a person somewhere else, but we were feeling uneasy. What were you thinking?
I swear to God, I at the time, I felt really we're at war. That was like, it's just like we're at war right now, and it was a nervous, scared. I was scared. And
who did you think you were at war with? What went through your mind?
I knew it was terrorists. I mean, the buildings had been attacked in 91. Remember, they tried to take them down with the truck bomb, and in the when they drove it in with the explosive, they tried to take down one of the towers in 91. But we knew it was terrorists right away. I mean, fundamentalist Muslims, but radicals. But you know, we kind of knew it was Bin Laden right away too. I mean, it was pretty clear who was going to do it, but. We never expected the scope of what happened. Like, I remember I was in my office in the 41st precinct with my executive staff watching. We were watching it on the television as well. We had the reports coming over. We were mobilizing people, deploying people to strategic locations, getting people down to assist down at Ground Zero. But we never expected the buildings to come down. And I remember watching on the TV when the buildings came down. It was like it was a stunning, stunning event.
What kind of calls were you getting from members of the public sitting in their house thinking the world was ending? Because you must have got those calls as well. Even though there was nothing happening to them personally there, they were sitting watching the television and their world was coming apart in front of them. What were they saying?
The funny thing that happened, Shaun, is from a policing standpoint, I don't want to call them nonsense radio calls, but all the regular stuff. Most people, like we were doing, were watching this incident on television. There was nothing really going on crime-wise, and people were just glued to their televisions. And the amazing thing that happened in America after that attack was the country became united. And I've never in my life felt anything like the patriotism that I felt at the time, and it was just palpable. I remember driving down to Ground Zero as in police, and we spent months going down there, I'm talking like 14 to 18 hour days, 7 days a week. And we would drive down, and as police officers, you don't usually get people cheering for you, and you usually go into negative things. You're arresting people, or people have been assaulted or robbed, and it's always negative stuff. But there were people lining the streets going down the West Side Highway or the FDR Drive, and clapping for us, cheering, holding out water for us, and food.
New York got manners.
It was unbelievable.
You know, because it's like, I don't want to be rude when I say it, but anyone who goes to New York realizes that it's a very, very fast place. You've got to live the fast lane. If you're not fast in the lift, they'll push you out the way. Get out the way. New York got manners, didn't it? Really?
It did. I understand what you're saying, and there's no offense taken by that comment, by the way, Shaun. I know exactly what you're talking about. New York is a very fast-paced city, and as you say, they'll push you out of the way, and if you're not, but it's like it did get manners, and it got but not just in New York, there were people came from everywhere. Well, rescue workers from all over the world came to help us, and I've said it in other interviews, there was police officers from Chicago, from Tennessee, Houston, that were directing traffic in Manhattan in the days thereafter. It was an unbelievable, the guys dressed in other city police uniforms helping, just doing anything to help out.
I'm just wondering, what are you thinking? What are your observations at the moment? And it's not like with like, obviously, but what's happening in the UK at the moment? These horrendous riots, they've calmed down, but they were very bad there for a couple of nights. And one particular night, I mean, it was absolute chaos. People were out then with brushes and doing their thing. There was this response from the public again.
Yeah.
But again, the police weren't able to handle. They didn't expect it. They said it was unprecedented. Do you know what that feeling's like? Or were you surprised at their lack of ability?
I don't want to knock the Metropolitan Police and the police in the other cities there, but because I don't know what all of the circumstances were, but I would like to think that wouldn't happen in New York, because that would be upsetting to me, because I think there's a lot of...
Well, would it happen in New York?
I couldn't see that happening in New York. We have... Again, I don't want to mix and match and knock another police department. It's not what I would ever do, but I couldn't see that happening in New York. We've got a tremendous police department. And police were
standing by watching it going on because they just couldn't. They hadn't the resources.
Yeah, well, we have a very good... we've got very good emergency plans in New York. We try to pre-plan for any events. Like, a lot of major events happen in New York. And like, what I'll bring up is the Republican National Convention for President Bush's second term, when there was a lot of anger and hatred towards President Bush after his first term, and the Republican National Convention came to New York City, which is extremely liberal and democratic, and there was hundreds of thousands of people there that were protesting, but there was no violence. There was some arrests, but there was nothing. There was no anarchy or violence on the scale that you saw there in England. That was crazy.
Just talk to us now about this
amazing exhibition, because it's unprecedented, isn't it? I mean, you're not in the police now, as in you're not a serving police officer. So you've decided on this course. Why?
Well, when I was the commander of the 4-1, when the incident happened, I met my now wife, Nicola, who was a photographer for the Irish Mean. She was working for the Irish Voice and Irish America magazine. And when 9/11 happened, Nicola got into Ground Zero, and she took some amazing pictures in the immediate aftermath. And she actually got pictures of the impacts from Brooklyn, and then she got into the Ground Zero zone right after the second tower fell. And in the days and weeks thereafter, she took a lot of pictures. But I know Nicola was very affected, as I was, by the victims down there, and the families that came down, desperately looking for their loved ones, was extremely sad.
Yeah.
And you mentioned one of the places I took you was to the down by the Port Authority, where all of the letters were up, and that's part of what our exhibition is. We have a wall of the missing. There was missing posters scattered, and you saw it, Shaun, all over New York. And they're so desperately sad, and there was a lot of people, like Nicola was down there, and there was people coming up to Nicola saying, "Have you seen my father? Have you seen my wife? And my son's missing. Please help me find." And it was just nothing you could do. There was no chance for anybody. And we're doing the exhibition in Chicago as well. And one example I'll give is there's a police officer we're honoring in Chicago, Brian McDonald. And a lot of the police and fire were, of Irish descent.
Irish, yeah.
And Fire Lieutenant Paul Mitchell. And their families are deeply involved in what we're doing, but their bodies were never recovered. Nothing from them were recovered.
Nothing.
And a lot of victims are in, and the families have nothing left of their love, except, that they know that they were down there helping, trying to evacuate. And with this exhibition, what we wanted to do, as I said, I know Nicola was very affected by it, and we wanted to ensure that we keep the memory alive and never forget. Because with the media cycles, as you know yourself nowadays, people tend to forget.
Mm.
And I went to the 13th Precinct after the 4-1, and I was the commander down there for 3 years. The 13th lost two police officers, Moira Smith and Robert Fazio. And next door to the 13th is ESU Truck 1, which is where Brian McDonald worked. So with Nicola's images, we came up with the idea a few years back that we should do something to keep the memory alive, and we came up with Ground Zero 360, which is an exhibition to honour the memory of the victims and to honour their families.
And I know Americans are great for wanting to go into museums and exhibitions, and they're mad into history when they visit places, especially their own, obviously. But would there be an appetite to look at that? Because there's obviously a huge depression element to it all as well.
The response, I was on the Miriam show on Saturday, and I can tell you, Shaun, the response that we have received on our Facebook and website and Twitter is just, it's inspiring. And I remember after 9/11, the day after, Ireland was the only country to have a national day of mourning. And there's a very strong link between Ireland and America, but especially the Irish cities like New York, Chicago, Boston. And I think Ireland felt very, very close and very affected by what happened, especially with New York. And the response has been amazing. You got to read some of the emails and these messages on Facebook from people that had relatives that were killed in there. There's a lot of people in Ireland that know people that were killed down in the towers, and it's amazing, the response. And the response, I have to say, the Irish government, the National Museum of Ireland, have been tremendous in supporting us in this project.
And of course, you mentioned the Donegal connection as well through the family, but which I know is really important always to mention as well, you know, when you're talking about it, especially when you're in Donegal, of course, because, you know, we always look to something that we can relate to, and obviously we had a person from Donegal who did.
Yeah, well, I was very,
I played, when I went over to New York first, the GAA was a very strong, bond for people to emigrate, and I played with Damien Meehan, played football, I played in the New York Miners, the New York junior team.
Is he from Donegal Town? Mike
Meehan, Mike, God rest his soul, and Peggy from Donegal Town, and a wonderful family. They have sons that were police and firefighters, Mike and Eugene and Kevin, and we would kill each other on the football field when the police played the fire department every year in our annual game. But Damien was a brilliant individual. Everybody loved Damien. He was a brilliant footballer and just a great human being. And I like to always mention Damien because we were the same age, and we played on the same teams, and we traveled together. And
you always say it could have been me.
Possible. But Damien, like Keith has said, one thing, when Damien's body was recovered, God rest Damien, he was recovered with a bunch of firemen. And it's nice to think that he was with friends, when it happened. So,
where can people see this exhibition, though?
The exhibition is at the Field Museum in Chicago. If anybody's in America,
the Ryder Cup's there next year. Isn't the Ryder Cup there next year?
I think it is. For Ireland, it's in the National Museum of Ireland at Collins Barracks. It opens up on August 18th to the general public, and it's free admission. If you want to follow us, you can go onto the Facebook. It's Ground Zero 360, and the website is ground0360.org. It's, as I said, free admission 6 days a week, and we'd love to have you there. We have the Nicholas images. We got Twisted Steel from Ground Zero, as well as artifacts from Moira Smith.
And, how often are you there, then?
I go back and forth quite a bit to New York. Yeah, I do. And by the way, speaking of New York, I know my mom and dad got up this morning. I love you guys. I know mom probably is the breakfast cook. My mother, Teresa from Donegal Town, Teresa Hanna, best woman I know in the world. She's just a great woman. And she loves your show, by the way. She loves listening to you, Shaun.
Thanks, Teresa.
Yeah, and when I'm on with the Hanna family, my aunt Bridie and Uncle Liam, their 50th wedding anniversary is tomorrow. And I was supposed to be there for it tomorrow. And I have to apologize, Auntie Bridie. I have to get up to Collins Barracks to take care of this exhibition, but congratulations on a wonderful marriage.
Why did you finish your career? Because you still look like you should be, I don't know, you're a very young man, and you look even younger than you are. So why did you stop? I mean, I was expecting to hear that you were the head of the police in New York.
Well, I did my 20 years. I mean, I've seen a lot, and I got four young boys. My Paul's 7, I got twin 5-year-olds and a 3-year-old, and I'd like to spend some time with my boys. My wife's from Dublin, and I'm very, very happy with my career. I love the NYPD. I had a tremendous 20 years. I've seen unbelievable things, and had a brilliant career. I have no complaints, no regrets, and I'm looking forward to this new leg of what I'm doing. It's
very different.
It's very different.
You miss the uniform?
I occasionally, but not really. I'm happy with my life right now. I have a great family life, and it's good. I mean, life is good. And just another shout out, Shaun, to I came up to Donegal last night, and staying with my brother Emmett and his beautiful wife and new daughter, Lucy. So hi to his new daughter Lucy.
Okay.
She's a lovely baby girl.
The Facebook link, by the way, for people to have a look, is
Ground Zero 360.
Ground Zero 360. By the way, hello to Paul. Thanks for looking after us so well when we were there. Joe and Angela O'Donnell, of course, and also Peter Kotleff called in to wish you best wishes. The former Stranola vocational student. You'll know him, PJ and Anna Blake, and I know there'll be many, many, many more who'll be saying the same. And great to see you again.
All right, Shaun.
And if we're ever in Chicago, go and see the exhibition.
And in Dublin, as I said, right now. So it's again, the support from the Donegal people has been tremendous. And I would like to say one last thing to the Donegal football team.
Mm-hmm.
I was in McLean Avenue when you beat Kildare, and that was made us proud to call ourselves Donegal men, that victory. And we got two more mountains to climb, Jim McGuinness. Let's get it done. Let's stick it to the Dubs, all right?
Actually, you'd be a good man to go along and motivate them as well. Not that all motivation is welcome, but from a guy like you, I'd say they would appreciate that.
All right. Well, listen, they've done us proud, and I'll tell you, it is. We watched that game, and it's a Donegal bar up on McLean Avenue in Yonkers, and
right.
it was spine tingling. The victory, it was one of the best games we've ever seen as Donegal men. So great job, guys, and keep it going.
Tell us about these cameras, by the way. What's going on here? Because I've had to come in a sort of nice T-shirt today because I knew you were having cameras to look at us.
We've got another fine Donegal man here, Shane Wallace from Wallace Media, who's been documenting the whole thing. I mean, he's been interviewing the individuals involved in the project with the family. Families, the Smith family. Jimmy Smith and his daughter Patricia are coming over for the exhibition here in Dublin, as well as the O'Rourke family, who are from Monaghan. Kevin O'Rourke's mother was from Monaghan, and I tell you, they got some awesome stories, man. And they got we've got a firefighter, Michael Lynch, who died on 9/11. His father gave us some steel for the event, and they're all coming over. And Shane Wallace here from Wallace Media has been documenting the whole thing for us, and he's putting up some tremendous stuff for us online, and it's a credit to him. Another fine Donegal man. We've got so much support from all over the country, but I have a strong affinity to Donegal. I'm a proud Donegal man, and it's nice to see it.
As always, we could chat forever, but thanks very much for joining us.
Thanks, Sean. Good man.
Paul McCormack, and we'll be back after this break. We'll see you in a couple of minutes' time. See you then.